Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, my co-panelist Ambassador Mudgal. Being the last speaker of the day is little like the last batsman who comes out when the result of the match is already decided. So you wonder how many balls you just got to last before the match comes to close of play. Notwithstanding that, I think Ambassador Mudgal has very beautifully set the stage for what I am going to say, because he brought out the need for us to build bridges of friendship, the compelling need and the requirement, as he said, to use his words. And I am trying to go and propose one way or one vector with which we can build these bridges of friendship. And I am going to say that perhaps your defense assets can themselves be great vehicles to build bridges of friendship, even though the proposition on the face of it might seem a bit contradictory. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to make it very clear that this, what I say, while it's indeed informed by my many years in the Navy, this is not the Navy's official viewpoint. It's entirely my personal viewpoint and is a product of my PhD thesis that I'm submitting in a couple of days to the Bombay University, which is on defense diplomacy applied to the East African region. So this is very familiar to those who are in the Navy, but what I have done is just turned the, since the globe is round, just turned the map upside down, and now you see how much the waters matter to us, how much the Indian Ocean matters to us. Because when we tend to see everything from a north-up position, with Delhi as the center, no matter you are covered from waters from all the side, you still think that the land is more important, you know. So that's what we in the Navy call as the continental mindset. But if you just were to invert, you will see that you can have the oceanic mindset. Now, very briefly, I'm just determining what are the basic contours of India's maritime geography. This is because, as we all brought out, this is a common space, Indian Ocean, history, there are lots of things. But amongst the two very important things, again, one, India is the only country after which an ocean is named. So it indicates our centrality, as Ambassador brought out, in this ocean. Second, this is one ocean geographically is closed from the north. Therefore, unlike Atlantic and Pacific that are open both ends, this is an ocean that has entries and exits only from certain points in south, which we call as choke points. So now in Navy, we have to be very conscious of geography. So geography plays a big, big part in the Indian Ocean region. The ambassador has already brought out mausam or monsoon, the winds, which were very peculiar and which enabled people in this part of the world to have trade and exchanges long before people in Europe had even got out of their, diapers. Therefore, you're talking of a place and zone which was in some way what we call today's Indo-Pacific, little bit of geography here and there, was a common oceanic space where this geography determined a lot of it. Now, in this oceanic space, of late, we have given lots of attention to two parts. West Asia, because we have lots of interest there, energy flows are from there, that's a place constantly in some sort of ferment. And then we have also focused a lot on Southeast Asia. Our look east and act east policy are weighted towards that region. What we unfortunately do is sometimes forget what is called the southwestern flank. We're not looking sufficiently southwest, which is the area of East Africa, West Indian Ocean region, and the Horn of Africa. Now, again, well known to most naval people, but Indian Ocean is a very busy ocean. Despite being smaller in size to the Atlantic and Pacific, global trade, it is the hub of global trade, lots of container traffic, lot of energy, everything flows through here, and the what are called the sea lines of communication, most of them go through the Indian Ocean. We are very beautifully placed in this region, geography-wise. Now, unfortunately, whereas we are blessed with geography, we are somewhat cursed with the neighborhood in terms of security. You see, everywhere you were to draw an arc from Indian Ocean, go from Afghanistan, Pakistan, go west, go to Yemen, go to the problems that are happening in the Gulf, go down to Somalia, go south down there, piracy, whole lot of other issues, and then you go east, Bangladesh, Burma. I mean, this is a region which has lots of political problems. It has lots of low-intensity conflicts. It's also the epicenter of many global disasters. So the Indian Ocean is a rather interesting place where India is somewhat extremely blessed geographically and somewhat fraught in terms of what are the political issues bearing in this region. Now, this is India and the Indian Ocean, and now our southwestern flank. This is what I mean, though I am going to be concentrating largely on East Africa in terms of Kenya, Tanzania, Mauritius, and those places. But this is, in a sense, not the West Asia Arab Peninsula, but the part below, which is East Africa littoral, Horn of Africa. Another way to look at it gives you a closer look. Please look at Madagascar, Mauritius down south, Seychelles further north. Why is this area very important to us? Now, for many of you who are followers of geography or anthropology, it's where? Kenya and Tanzania is where the origins of mankind took place, the Olduvai Gorge in Tanzania, whatever. But more importantly, we've had lots of ancient and recent links. And the funny point is, it is different in different ways. We've had lots of seafaring links with them for 2,000 years plus. More recently, the railway line in Kenya was almost entirely built with Indian laborers. We've had Indian peacekeeping forces go there and be involved in Africa in a big way. And now there's a new set of professionals, IT, banking, service sector, a whole lot of them who are there. The Indian diaspora there, and again, it's very, what one might say, it's a fantastic mixture. In Mauritius, you have the Jahazbhais from Bihar. In Seychelles, you have a mix of Tamilians and Gujaratis. In Kenya, you have the Goans. You have the Sadajis, the Punjabis who came to build the railway line. You have the Gujaratis who are into business. Tanzania is more Gujarati. So it's a wonderful mix. Reunion has people from Pondicherry. What it does, in a sense, it gives you an advantage that several people from India can have connections with different aspects of the diaspora there. Of course, there is turbulence in the Horn of Africa, which is our maritime neighborhood. Piracy was brought out by the ambassador, and piracy affected us because it started moving eastward, and it's only some very much precipitate action by India that enabled it to be put back. And there's a huge amount of extra-regional presence. I don't know if Admiral Dhawan mentioned it, but there are anywhere from 45 to 65 ships of so many navies operating in the Indian Ocean at any time. We're talking of warships. So there's extra-regional presence, the Europeans, the Americans, the Russians, and China, of course, in a big way. Now, all of this sort of affects our own overview. What else? The current situation. Now, most of us tend to think of Africa through certain stereotypes. One of them is, of course, the classic safari one, where you can find lots of animals and great places, savannas and grasslands. Other is some little bit of, these people are good in sport or something like that. And because it's a single landmass, say for the islands, we tend to think of it often as one country. We don't remember that it is 54 nations there. So you tend to look at them uniformly, and you're not able to make out. Often when I was in Nairobi, I used to be told, you are in Nigeria. You know, now, Kenya is East Africa, Nigeria is West. There's thousands of miles between them. And this was not by some uninformed relatives, but by reasonably informed citizens, you know, fairly influential in their line of work. Mauritius gets very much confused with Mauritania. You know, so there are all a whole lot of these things that happen when it comes to Africa. Or it does not figure much in our mindscape, despite the fact that governments, you know, particularly the government of India has been doing enormous work in the last 5 years. From 2014, Prime Minister Modi said Africa is our top priority, but it's not accompanied by a similar, you know, acceleration in terms of our own imagination, our conception, and how we look at that continent. Huge now, however, huge growing market. It is a source of natural resources. India is interested there. Lots of resources that come in from Africa, and therefore there is renewed interest. Now, since I'm going to be talking of defense diplomacy, what is our defense presence there? In terms of defense attaches, we've got five. One each in the four corners: Egypt in north, Kenya in east, South Africa in south, and Nigeria in the west. Very recently, we put in a sort of half defense attache. I mean, it's a defense attache, but limited to Sudan. Other than that, we got training teams and liaison observers and something like that in Uganda and Tanzania and Seychelles and Mauritius. Mauritius, there's a fairly high presence of the Indian Navy and the Indian Air Force. Then we've got peacekeepers. 3,000 people in Congo and about 2,000 plus in Sudan, the two peacekeeping missions. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is important. We don't know what a sort of equity it gives to you. When I was there as a defense attache in Nairobi, there would be guys from Europe or someone saying, oh, we have decided to commit so many people for this effort in Kenya, or so many people for this thing in Tanzania. And they used to commit 10 people, 4 people, 5 people and talk about it. It used to come in newspaper. Hungary has promised to bring some military observer for this. 4, 5, 2. So when I would tell them in defense attaché meetings that we got 6,000 people in this continent, there was consternation. They did not know. The problem, though, is that when people don't know, they do not sufficiently appreciate what you are doing there. So what are our strengths in this region? One is proximity, of course, and we have power. And when I say power, I mean the power of influence, the power of someone who's been good, the power of someone who's largely been norm-abiding, soft power as much as hard power, influence, strength. Military assets, we are respected, ladies and gentlemen, in that part. I mean, there are certain aspects, sometimes some people have tended to be, some of the diasporic Asians have tended to be a bit more adventurous in business, or somewhat they've tended to be the brown side, being a little racial, but by and large, Indians are respected in East Africa at least. We're held up to be role models, we're held up to be some people. You know, the West intimidates them, the West awes them, but they look on India as someone who has been, someone like them, but has been able to go ahead despite all the challenges. So they look up to you very much. The diaspora, of course, huge source of strength. We have not leveraged that completely. Lots of cultural soft power issues, and I can illustrate everything from Bollywood, cinema, art, a whole lot of ancient culture, cuisine in many ways. You can get up in Mauritius in the morning and on radio you can hear, you know, the kind of bhajans that you would probably hear back in India on the FM radio. And there are various other intangibles that we could discuss about later. So having framed this, I bring you to the point of defense diplomacy and why. One, of course, conceptually, I do believe that defense diplomacy, which is non-coercive use of military assets, and a lot of people can have questions at how you can do it. I'll try and explain. But this is a new paradigm that's finding global acceptance. And there is a reason why. Because many times, the defense forces have within them a whole lot of assets to be able to do good. It's the same thing as a forest guard being enormously suited, if he learns about the forest, to be able to guard it from the environmental perspective as well as from the shikars and other people. So when defense forces have lot of assets amongst themselves, they're usually the first responders to any sorts of crisis. They come in huge numbers. They're able to do a whole lot of graduated thing, right from humanitarian assistance and disaster relief at the bottom end of the spectrum to war fighting at the top end, which means there's a unique set of attributes, whole lot of organic assets. Then you feel that a slight change in direction helps defense forces to be uniquely capable of doing diplomacy. Now, let me emphasize, defense diplomacy is not a departure from traditional diplomacy. It is, in fact, as I would like to argue, it is a big, you know, an arrow in the quiver of your diplomatic options. It is a big vector that you can use whenever you need to use it. And within that, the Indian Armed Forces have several attributes. Professionalism, great professionalism, and this stands out in contrast to the armed forces of East Africa. We represent India in our heterogeneity and in our diversity. Any shape, any army regiment represents the best of India. You take a made in India ship today, anywhere, in, for example, in Kenya, you're showing him the best of Indian technology. You have a Sadaji, a Christian, a Muslim, a Parsi, everyone on that ship. You're showing him the best of Indian diversity. You give him excellent khana there, you're going showing him the best of Indian cuisine. You play some Bollywood music during the reception, you're showing him a great deal of soft power. And most importantly, you are giving him a feel of what India is in its entirety. Therefore, there are many attributes. I mean, the fact that Indian Armed Forces have never been involved in a coup is very important, because as a country that cherishes democracy and talks of democracy in a soft way, unlike the West, we don't hector to the people there about democracy, nor are we predatory unlike the Chinese. The essence, the good of India, I would argue, is uniquely and best represented by the Indian Armed Forces there, in particular by naval ships that go there on missions. However, for this to happen, we need a whole of government or sometimes a whole of nation approach. Now, this is what the Kenyan Chief of Army Staff told me. Now, this is not something he told me on one-to-one. He said this at an open meeting with other defense attaches. Almost every Kenyan, when I was there, almost every Kenyan, everyone in Seychelles, every Tanzanian chief had done one or other course in India. And they were very categorical that they just admired the course in India. They said, yours is the most realistic. When we go to West, they give us lots of junket. It's good life. But we admire what you teach us in India. It stays. The Kenyan Navy chief was a staff college graduate from India. He said, dying desire that you give me more staff college vacancies for my Navy. And you know, I was wondering why we were not able to give naval vacancies to them despite a great deal of effort from my side, and found that every time there was a fight in them, where the army would snatch the Navy's vacancies. So I, of course, told him lightheartedly, the situation is the same in India too. But the whole point is the demand that was there for Indian training. So what do we do? And how do we do this? How do we do defense diplomacy? You know, I can tell you various ways in which, but we got to capitalize. One, we said, capitalize on our strengths. There is a ready-made turf there. I gave you one example of our peacekeeping operations. I mean, in 2010, the Chinese ship Peace Ark visited Kenya. Now, Chinese went out of their way. The vice president of Kenya was there in Mombasa to receive. Every Chinese was there. School children were waving flags. Whole lot of things happened. It was made as if China has had lifelong relationship with East Africa. The last time before 2010 when a Chinese ship visited, known fact in history, when a Chinese ship visited Mombasa before 2010 was sometime in 1432 when the great Chinese Admiral Tung Ha came there. And the Indian Navy and Indian ships and Indian dhows have been visiting that place every year. But we did not make a show, a song and dance of our being there. Now, in some way, you got to sort of capitalize on these assets. You got to keep saying, telling everyone very slowly, very nicely, telling the whole world. You know, it is like that admiral who encountered, one of Indian admirals who encountered the Americans. This is not a story of the South Indian Ocean, but of the North Arabian Sea, when the aircraft carrier group from the Americans met Indians. This was just after 2001, and Americans were there in huge way here. And the American admiral greeted the Indian flagship and the Indian admiral and said, "Indian Navy, so-and-so, good to see you. How long have you been here?" And the Indian admiral replied back. He said, "We have been here before Christ. What about you?" No? Now, this is what message we need to send across, that we have been here before Christ. No? So we have to find a way in which we are able to. Now, there is new security architecture. We have to invoke new paradigms, generate win-win solutions. And I think Ambassador Mudgal has been very, very humble. But Sagar, which was coined when the Prime Minister visited Mauritius, when he was there, I think it's such a wonderful acronym, because security and growth for all in the region, it is, you know, first, when you say security and growth, for the first time you're recognizing that security and growth can go hand in hand. That one is not at the cost of other. You say all, that means you are emphasizing sabka saath, sabka vikas, as he said, that okay, we are all in it together. There's nothing discriminatory. We're not putting out anything from there. And region, you're talking of this region, Indian Ocean region. So you have to, but of course, now you got to make that work. One way possibly that I have suggested is IORA and the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium should marry, because IORA did lots of good things, but it did not have security as a part of its architecture till about 2011 or something like that. It needs to have probably greater security focus without going away from its development aspect. So maybe the horse of IONS get hitched to the wagon of IORA, wherein IONS gets headquarters in Mauritius, it's able to have a defense component. I don't know how much it's workable, but probably we could do that. But we got to look at new paradigms to work within this place. Sell our services well. One of the big problems East Africans have is they're unable to come to India. We do great amount of training, but they're unable to come to India. What the Westerners do frequently is they do 1 or 2 weeks courses there. Of course, they advertise it a great deal, but they take small training teams and often they engage their ex-servicemen. You know, India is the only country that doesn't use ex-servicemen in the pursuit of its defense diplomacy. You go to West Africa, after piracy, almost every person I met in the conference who was going to build a radar for Kenya or who was doing something else was an ex-serviceman from one of the European or American countries. We can do a lot more in that region, bringing in, engaging them so that we don't always tax our in-service people, but are able to have the same thing. So we got to find different ways to sell our wares. Now, this is indeed difficult, ladies and gentlemen, because after piracy, what happened? I'll tell you a good incident. Seychelles, now they said that, okay, one way to, it was completely affected by piracy. As the ambassador said, for us, oceans are a lifeline. For them, it's life itself. There was deathly silence in Seychelles after the first piracy. I happened to be there from 2008 to 12 when piracy was at its peak. And unfortunately, during my first call on in January, I told them that, look, piracy is around the corner. You got to do something about it. And that time they said, no, We are nice people, we are peace-loving people. You know, the standard problem that some people in India have, that if you are peace-loving, that others will be equally peace-loving. You know, so this thing that, oh, we are peace-loving, nothing will happen to us, happen to them. Now, when piracy hit and some of the people were taken hostage, they thought I was some sort of a astrologer, soothsayer. I mean, it wasn't any rocket science, so I was summoned quickly. Achha, what can you do? Anyway, so one of the great ideas they brought, I thought very good. They said, we'll do a carnival to get people back into normalcy, showcase our tourism and things like that. So I had to make a pitch for a ship to come to carnival in Seychelles. Of course, I got a big bollocking from my naval headquarters. Arey, what are you doing? You are less of Indian defense attaché to Seychelles and more of Seychelles defense attaché to India. You know, hum Indian Navy ka jahaj patrolling ke liye bhi bhejenge, ye bhi bhejenge, ab carnival ka bhi bhejna padega. You know, obviously the Indian Navy had problems. Anyway, to cut a long story short, we managed to do it. You know, the first year for the carnival, to advertise it, they had brought a Brazilian troupe, so it was advertised with that big Brazilian samba girl, you know, in her lovely yellow dress and all that. India took part in the first edition of the carnival. Our ships were there. There was a fly past. We took part in the fly past. There was a fantastic city parade. Our sailors did beautiful bhangra, including some sardars. Every ship has some sardars, and sardars are actually wonderful. Come in, sir. Great for defense diplomacy. You know, they're great for defense diplomacy. And then we had some food stalls set up with biryani. Huge hit. Ladies and gentlemen, next year the advertisement poster for the Seychelles Carnival, you had a full-fledged photograph, one half the samba girl, the other half the sadar doing the bhangra. You know? Now, this is the way you got to sort of sell these issues. The defense forces, armed forces, we operate in very, you know, siloed way, partly also because we are instructed to do so. But I think my own opinion is that we got to do a lot more through think tanks, through universities, through civil society organizations, NGOs, corporates. In a big way, we got to sort of set, discuss, see how we can do defense diplomacy. And I can give you one good example of how we badly goofed up on few things. I mean, relatively speaking, one of the things that happened after piracy in Seychelles, 2010, we promised them a coastal radar chain in 2010. And in 2010, the same year, UAE promised them a coastal radar chain too. So both of us had our independent radar chains to do. Now, 1 year later, UAE had delivered the coastal radar chain to them. October 2010, they had signed the agreement. November 2011, they had given them. And our coastal radar chain was nowhere near completion. So I was invited for the ribbon cutting event. It was embarrassing to say why India has not been able to do, but we assured them, don't worry, it will be done, ours will be much better. And I came out and I see a very familiar face. I said, "Arey, tu kya kar raha hai yahan pe?" It's a naval colleague, you know, Indian Navy fellow. He said, "Sir, I just quit the service 2 or 3 years ago." He was an electrical officer, short service commissioned officer. "I just completed my tenure in the Navy and I quit after 3 or 6 months ago, so I'm here." I said, "All that is okay, but what are you doing here?" He says, "Who do you think did this for the UAE?" You know? So, in effect, you had an Indian Navy officer deliver a coastal radar chain to Seychelles without, from UAE, because UAE didn't bother about who did it. They outsourced it. Whereas we went through a stovepipe, MOD, MEA, Bell, PSU, Kon Karega, and ultimately it took us 5 years to deliver on that project. You know, not for want of capability. We have huge amount of capability, but for want of decision making, the way things happen in our system. So basically what I'm trying to say is military can be used as a smart power tool. In fact, it's very good as a smart power tool because the hard power and soft power coexist together, but we have to use it in an imaginative way. So very simple, my last couple of slides. We got to do much more in each of these things. I think he's brought out very well training, but we are training about, you know, every year we could be training about 1,000 people from that region, you know. But what we don't do is we're not good at alumni networks. We're not good at keeping tabs of who is where. We're not good at calling them for receptions later. You know, it's surprising. When I met the Tanzanian chief first time, he said, I've done this course in Kochi. None of us knew it. You know, so you had to go back, find out. Of course, he was delighted when we presented some photographs of his time there. And now the Westerners are so good at this. They have alumni networks. They invite you. They do a whole lot of things. I mean, this age of database, email, connectivity and all that, we both need to think this well, and we need some government rules to liberalize on these issues. You know, much more, we are doing huge amount for hydrography, and I will tell you that in my last slide in a way. Capability building, capacity enhancement. I mean, what we are doing in terms of EZ patrols for Seychelles and Mauritius, what we are doing in terms of hydrography surveys for Seychelles, Tanzania, Mauritius, Kenya, what we are doing in terms of training, what we are doing in set of training teams, what we are doing in terms of peacekeeping. I don't think anyone has been doing that kind of thing there. But we don't know. They don't know in the continent, we don't know in India, rest of Indian decision makers don't know, and therefore we are unable to leverage this for anything. You want to leverage this for corporates, you are unable to do it because you are not aware. Somebody wants to leverage it for soft power, they are unable to do it. I mean, I'd argue that rather than sending cultural troops, you can do much more through this. But anyway, so we need to do much more visits, much more this one. And of course, we need greater sensitization in the MOD and MEA. MEA is brilliant, but the number of people you got, you are aware. At 900 people, we got the same strength as those of Singapore. You know, the least strength in terms of our officers. I mean, okay, they work hard, they do a lot, but they can't be present all the time. On the other hand, I mean, a typical mission, our mission in Mombasa had 5 people. So how much can they do even though they are there continuously? When one ship goes there, you are talking of 200, 300 people who are suddenly your ambassadors. So the amount of difference they can make is huge. I would also argue, and this is a little controversial, but I'd also argue that where development is concerned, the defense forces can do a lot. I'll give you one small example, particularly when there's huge amount of asymmetry between that nation and the others. Maldives, Male had a water crisis two years ago. So what did the Indian Navy do? And please remember, water crisis there means that their RO plants had shut. None of their people could get water, none of their tourists could get water, none of their hotels could get water. The country would have shut down. So first the Indian Navy goes, it gives huge amounts of water, ready-made water, instant relief. Then the Indian Navy uses its reverse osmosis plants to make lots of water. That's the second stage of help. Then the Indian Navy's technical experts go there and repair the RO plant there. So what you're doing is not technical repairs. You're bringing the country back to its feet. And no matter what its size and number of people, at the end of the day, it's a country. The same thing happens in Seychelles. When you do, but what it has done, thankfully, in recent years, it has produced some literature after all. This is ambassador, IFS officer who was our ambassador in Philippines, and he has written this lovely book. So there is greater convergence between the MEA and the armed forces on how diplomatic, maritime diplomacy and defense diplomacy can play a big part in the conduct of national diplomacy. There's also another tool, another book like this, written by a colonel. So what are the various options that we can produce? Therefore, while more or less agreeing in a large sense with what the ambassador has said, I'd also like to say that a whole lot of non-traditional threats, yes, of course, non-traditional threats are difficult to meet than traditional ones because they're difficult to predict. But by the same token, if a climate disaster happens, who will be the first to respond? It's the armed forces. Whether you are evacuating people, you're giving rescue and relief, you're policing the oceans to make sure that unregulated fishing doesn't happen, you're making sure that pollution doesn't happen. After all, historically, it was the Royal Navy, despite whatever role that the British played, the Royal Navy played a great role in ending slavery. Therefore, it is possible for the armed forces to do a lot of social good also, if we are able to imagine them in that way. I'll end with this, wonderful tale which illustrates everything that is nice about defense diplomacy. This is the chart of the port of Tanga presented by Admiral Lamba, our CNS, to the Prime Minister of Tanzania in 2017. Now, port of Tanga is very important in some sense because northern port, it is other than Dar es Salaam, it is another port that Tanzania has. But it has a checkered history. In World War I, not many people are aware, there was something called the Battle of Tanga. It was a disastrous amphibious expedition mounted by the British. They wanted to displace Germans. Tanzania those days were held by the Germans. And they thought that by getting the sliver of port from the Germans, they'll be able to effectively block the Germans completely. As it turned out, this was from 2nd to 4th or 5th of November 1915 or 1914. It turned out to be a completely disastrous operation. The Royal Navy was involved, not the Royal Indian Navy, but the Indian Army was involved in a huge way. More than 1,000 Indians died in that battle. And despite, it's also called the Battle of Bees because many beehives, it was fought in a half forested place. Many beehives were disturbed. It's kind of tragicomic. Both sides scored lots of self goals. But ultimately, the Germans prevailed. They had very few losses. And Indians had to retreat. Rather, the British had to retreat. Huge amount of Indian bloodshed. And Tanga was a disaster. And it's those sort of things which didn't have any romantic aura also about it, like Gallipoli or Flanders or Somme or anything like that. Now, 100 plus years later, we have an Indian Navy hydrographic ship doing survey of the port of Tanga. So hydrographic survey illustrates our expertise in a very small area of specialization. It's like an exclusive club, like a satellite, nuclear, space. Those who are able to do hydrography is a very small club. And the Indian Navy and the Indian hydrography is a part of that exclusive club. So by doing Port Tanga hydrographic survey, which had not been done for years, you showcased your scientific prowess, you showcased your naval prowess, you showcased the international cooperation aspects of the Indian Navy, right? By giving a chart of Port of Tanga, you also indicated in some ways that the history of the disaster of Tanga could be forgotten or could be brought to a close. What happened under Brits, a colonial power where Indians lost their lives and Tanzanians have bad memories, now could hopefully be remedied. And by a coincidence, the naval chief presented the chart on 28th of July 2017. 28th July, as we're all aware, is the date when the First World War started. So in a sense, 100 years later, the Indian Navy put a closure to what had happened and showed, even if subconsciously, that defense forces can be a force for greater good in this world and in this part of the region. Thank you. I will leave you with that part of this one.